بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Let me to introduce their guest today, Professor Ahmed Al-Asmi. He's one of the very active professors at Urology and Nephrology Center. As you see, he's born in 71, so he's approaching 50 years. He is a professor of urology at Urology and Nephrology Center since 2015, so 5 years now after the professorship. And I think all of us are honored to work in the Urology and Nephrology Center. Professor Al-Asmi always has his activities and always hemodialysis courses. Professor Al-Asmi, the feedback for his presentation is always excellent. He is active member of all Urology Society, Egyptian, Arab, European, United States. So he's very unique professor. He had international publications in high quality journals, 97 publications, 2 research projects, big projects. He supervised 13 master degree and 9 MD degree. And he, I attended one of his discussion. He is very meticulous in his assessment and judgment. Because of his research profile, he is considered as an international reviewer for many journals, 13 international journals. Professor Ahmed Al-Asmi is active reviewer in them, and he is one of the editorial board for 2 international urology journals. Because of all these research activities, he is awarded many times. He is awarded Dr. Mohammed Fakhri 2 times, the awarded National Encouragement Prize, جائزة الدولة التشجيعية in Egypt 2 times, and this is an exception to have the National Encouragement Prize for two times, and the international awards from many conferences, many foundations, including Masr al Khair for the publications and the citation. So we are honored to have Professor Ahmed Al-Asmi with us at Urology and Nephrology Center. Regarding his activities with nephrology education, he has 7 lectures. I know that you don't know that you have 7 lectures at the ASNT virtual academies and 3 videos. And this is one of his presentation about erectile dysfunction in hemodialysis in the African course. And all the African guests were excited and considered the erectile dysfunction as very hot topic in the medicine and nephrology. And the last presentation with us was establishment of Urology for Nephrologists playlist by delivering the basics of urinary stones last March. Today, he will discuss erectile dysfunction in general. Then he will focus on the nephrology perspectives, CKD dialysis, and renal transplantation. I'm expecting hot discussions. And this is one of the very nice photos gathering me and Professor Al-Asmi. Always I'm happy to deal with Professor Al-Asmi because of his expertise and his unique character. It is a pleasure, Dr. Al-Asmi, to have you with us, with nephrology community, this session. And we are expecting exciting presentation and hot discussion at the end. Thank you very much for your attending with us today. So this is your presentation. I'm going to chair. Dr. Karim, if the presentation is okay. Dr. Karim.
Yeah, okay.
Do you see the slides of erectile dysfunction?
Yes. Okay. Yes.
So the I'm introducing Professor Last.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. First, I would like to thank my dear colleague Professor Hussein Shaisha for his nice introduction for me and for his kind invitation to present this lecture with you. And it really gives me an honor to be with you today. The title of our subject today is erectile dysfunction and chronic renal disease. I know most of us are nephrologists, and topic of erectile dysfunction is not the main interest for us. So today we will discuss briefly physiology of normal erection, basic causes and evaluation of patient with erectile dysfunction, and basic treatment of erectile dysfunction. Why it is important to start with evaluation and treatment in general? Because the same steps done in general population, these will use it in patient with chronic renal failure or patient with renal transplantation. The same idea of evaluation, the same lines of treatment. And the next half of our subject, we will discuss passive physiology and treatment of erectile dysfunction in chronic renal failure patient and effect of renal transplant on erectile function. So first, start briefly with the anatomy of the penis. As all of you know, penis is composed of three cylindrical bodies, two corpora cavernosa, which are responsible for erection. They are the erectile tissues. And one corpus spongiosum, it surrounds the urethra and form a distal expansion, which is the glands. Corpus spongiosum is not involved in erection. The main blood supply to the penis comes from the pudendal artery, which is branch of the internal iliac artery. And remember that we use this artery for renal transplantation. So we will mention later that renal transplant may affect erectile function because of decreased blood supply to the penis, because the main blood supply is through the pudendal artery, which is a branch of the internal iliac artery. The venous drainage of the patient is not simple as the arterial supply. Actually, it is formed of three drainage systems, superficial, intermediate, and deep, and it is very complex rather than the arterial supply. But simply, the venous drainage finally drains into the deep dorsal vein, which evacuates into the internal pudendal vein, then into the internal iliac. The innervation of the venous is very important. It is divided into autonomic and somatic. Somatic is via the pudendal nerve. Autonomic, sympathetic, and parasympathetic. Sympathetic is from thoracic 11 to lumbar 12, and it is responsible for maintaining the placid condition of the penis. On the contrary, parasympathetic arises from sacral 2 to 4, and it is responsible for erection. So parasympathetic is responsible for erection, and sympathetic is responsible for maintaining the placid condition of the penis. The basic physiology for normal erection: under resting condition, the sympathetic tone prevails. So the smooth muscles of the arterioles and sinusoids are tonically contracted. This allows small blood flow to the penis for nutrition. But with sexual stimulation, release of certain mediator, that will finally cause smooth muscle relaxation of the arterioles and of the sinusoid. Vasodilatation will lead to large amount of blood comes to the penis, which will fill the sinusoid. Filling of the sinusoid will cause enlargement of the sinusoid, distension of the penis, increased intracorporeal pressure. This will lead to compression of subtunical emissary veins, decreasing the venous retail. So I will increase the venous input and decrease the blood output. This will lead to more increase in the length of the venous and more increase in the intracorporeal pressure. But remember that there is no complete occlusion of the venous drainage. And if it occurs, this occurs for just a few seconds, just before ejaculation. So the circulation is not completely occluded, except for a few seconds, just before ejaculation. Most researchers now agree that nitric oxide released from the non-adrenergic, non-cholinergic nerve fiber and endothelial cells are the main mediator responsible for erection. This slide seems to be complicated, but it is very important to know the mechanism of erection. After release of nitric oxide from the endothelial cells and from the non-adrenergic, non-cholinergic nerve fiber, nitric oxide enter into the cells where it stimulates guanylyl cyclase, which transforms guanosine triphosphate into cycloguanosine monophosphate. Cycloguanosine monophosphate through certain protein kinase will close calcium channel in the cell. This will lead to decreased calcium inside the cell, and hypocalcemia inside the cell will lead to smooth muscle relaxation. This is a cascade for normal erection. But inside the cell, there is an enzyme called BDE5 or phosphodiesterase type 5 enzyme, which disrupts cycloguanosine monophosphate. So it interrupts the cascade for erection. Remember this mechanism, because when we say treatment for erectile dysfunction, we will mention BDE5 inhibitor. These drugs inhibit this enzyme to make the cascade of erection continuous. So this is a very important slide. So what is mean by erectile dysfunction? Erectile dysfunction is a problem of erection, and it is defined as inability of the male to attain and or maintain a benign erection sufficient for satisfactory sexual performance. Some patients may have difficulty to attain an erection from the start, and this is usually due to arterial problem. Some patients describe that they have initial erection, but during intercourse, there is detumescence. This is usually due to vena occlusive dysfunction. Erectile dysfunction is a very common problem. And historically, it was difficult to estimate the incidence of erectile dysfunction because patients were ashamed to go to the doctor and ask for help. But currently, with increased awareness of development of effective oral treatment, people usually seek medical treatment, and the incidence and the prevalence of erectile dysfunction are increasing. The prevalence of erectile dysfunction is highly related to age. With increasing age, there is increasing incidence of erectile dysfunction. Why? Because with age, there is structural changes that occur in the penis, so leading to incompetent vena occlusive mechanism and decreased blood supply like atherosclerosis, and this will lead to erectile dysfunction. Also with aging, there is increased comorbidities like chemical heart disease or diabetes mellitus, which are very common causes for erectile dysfunction. What are the general causes for erectile dysfunction? For simplicity, we classify causes as psychogenic and organic. For normal erection to occur, I should have normal arterial supply to the penis. I should have normal corporeal tissue. I should have normal innervation. I should have normal hormones like testosterone and prolactin. I should have normal what's called vena occlusive mechanism. In psychogenic causes, all these mechanisms are okay. No organic problem. But there is central inhibition from the cerebral cortex over the sacral spinal center, which are responsible for erection. An example for psychogenic causes like depression, like severe anxiety and stress. We have a very common cause here in Arab countries, which is honeymoon impotence. Usually due to stress and excessive fear of failure, the patient is unable to have an erection for intercourse. Other causes are classified as organic causes, and this may include an arterial problem and problem in arterial supply to the brain, like old patient with atherosclerosis, or young patient with motor car accident and pelvic trauma that may interfere with arterial blood supply to the penis. Patient with neurogenic problem like multiple sclerosis, cerebral stroke, Parkinsonian disease, trauma to the vertebral column, any causes which interrupt sympathetic or autonomic nervation to the penis may lead to erectile dysfunction. Hormonal abnormalities also are important. May include testicular problem like patient with hypogonadism, may include pituitary abnormalities like patient with hyperprolactinemia, and also patient with hypo or hyperthyroidism. Also cavernosal problem, patient with Peyronie disease. Peyronie disease, for as a brief, it is called fibrosis of the tunica albuginea. May occur in patient with diabetes or patient with minor blood penile trauma. This will lead to fibrosis of the tunica. During filling of the venous, there is incomplete distension of the venous at this site. So incomplete closure of major veins at this site of fibrosis. And usually there is vein occlusive dysfunction at this point. So erectile dysfunction, okay. Peyronie is fibrosis of the tunica albuginea. Also, there is very important systemic disease that may lead to erectile dysfunction. Diabetes mellitus is a very common, and many of them are complaining of erectile dysfunction. Diabetes mellitus affects erectile dysfunction by many ways. It leads to neuropathy, vasculopathy, and also endothelial dysfunction. What I mean by endothelial dysfunction, there is defect release of nitric oxide from the endothelial cells. Chronic renal failure, I will discuss at last in details, and liver cirrhosis. There is some what's called iatrogenic causes of erectile dysfunction. What I mean by iatrogenic, that I give medication to the patient that cause erectile dysfunction, or I do some operation to the patient that may lead to erectile dysfunction, like radical pelvic surgery, like radical prostatectomy or radical cystectomy. It will interfere with the neurovascular bundle to the patient. Patients with advanced cancer prostate are treated with hormonal treatment, like anti-testosterone, like patient with bilateral subcapsular orchiectomy or castration, or using anti-testosterone for treatment. There are many medications that we use that may cause erectile dysfunction, like antidepressant and antipsychotic. Some classes of antihypertensive, like beta blocker and centrally acting drugs, may lead also to erectile dysfunction. So be aware for this medication during prescription to your patient. Then if I faced with a patient with erectile dysfunction, how I should evaluate? The evaluation is divided into basic assessment and specialized investigation. We'll focus on the basic assessment because this is important for every doctor, not for the urologist only. And it should be done for every patient. Specialized investigation and done in selected cases and done by specialists. And it is out of scope of discussion today. So what is the basic assessment that I should do for my patient? Basic evaluation entail history, examination, and some laboratory tests. History include medical, surgical, and sexual. Medical and surgical as normal. Do you have any diseases like diabetes, ischemic heart? Did you do any operations that may interfere with penile blood supply that may be a cause for erectile dysfunction? The sexual history is very important. And we will focus on just two items that are very relevant and we should keep in mind, which is the onset and the course of duration, and presence and absence of nocturnal erection. Why? Because with these two questions, we can differentiate between psychogenic and organic. How? If I have an acute onset and intermittent dysfunction, intermittent course, this means I have a psychogenic element. How? For an example, intermittent course, if I have erectile dysfunction with my wife, but I have a good erection with another partner. This means I have a psychological problem with my wife. If I have an acute onset, for example, after death of one relative, some patient may complain of erectile dysfunction, or death of his child. So acute onset is related to a psychogenic element usually. But organic causes have gradual onset and stationary course. So acute onset and selective dysfunction are with psychogenic. Gradual onset with stationary course are with organic. Also, presence of morning erection is very important. If I have a good morning erection, this means that the erectile mechanism is okay. Maintenance of normal erection or morning erection, this means that I have a psychological problem. So keep in mind these two questions. It will differentiate between organic and psychogenic. Medical and surgical history usually give you a clue for the organic cause. So if I diagnose that the patient has organic cause from the sexual history, the medical and surgical history will point this organic cause. For example, diabetes, neurologic problem, any surgical operation. So history is very important. The second item for the basic evaluation is examination. And it's divided into general examination and examination of the genital system. General examination, like any general examination. Measure blood pressure, look for any signs of systemic disease like uremia, and look for secondary sexual character. Because absence of secondary sexual character may point to primary hypogonadism or secondary hypogonadism in young patients. I know that most of neurophrologists does not prefer to do genital examination, but it is very important for evaluation. You should look for the size of the testicles. If they are atrophic, you may point for hypogonadism. You should look for the penis for palpation of pyrone plaques or fibrosis. You should do PR examination to exclude neurologic problem if I have a lost anal tone, or if I diagnose suspicious of cancer prostate, this may be a contraindication for testosterone therapy if I won't use. What are the basic evaluations? The basic evaluation for a general patient with erectile dysfunction are do fasting blood sugar to exclude diabetes mellitus, lipid profile to diagnose hypercholesterolemia and hyperlipidemia. Some authors does not prefer to do serum testosterone and prolactin as general evaluation, and they recommended it when there is suspicion for hormonal abnormalities. So general evaluation may laboratory general evaluation may include fasting blood sugar, lipid profile, and for myself, I recommend testosterone and prolactin for patient with as a routine for patient with coronary renal impairment. Of course, there is high incidence of hormonal abnormalities in child patients. So for you, my dear colleague, the basic evaluation you should do for your patient, either it is have renal problem or not, is to do basic evaluation, history examination, and laboratory profile. Laboratory profile, fasting blood sugar, lipid profile, you can do prolactin and testosterone routine, no problem. Selected optional test, or this is usually for specialists. You can do ICI or tachycardia nozzle injection test or color Doppler ultrasound or rigid scan, and this is not the scope of our lecture today. Is it necessary to do much investigations for our patient? The diagram showing show you that history and examination can diagnose and sufficient for 70% of your patient. Specialized investigation are needed only in 20%. So there is need for extensive, complicated labs or radiological investigation. Just history and examination will show you are enough in 70% of cases to diagnose and to start your treatment. Just the history and examination in 70%. How I can treat patient with erectile dysfunction? even you are not indulged as a urologist or andrologist, you should do the primary care for erectile dysfunction. What are the primary care? Is to modify reversible causes of erectile dysfunction. And you can use the first line of treatment for erectile dysfunction, which are oral treatment. And currently now we have low intensity shockwave therapy. So primary care is for every doctor. You should know and you should do it for your patient. The second and third line of treatment usually done by specialist and include the second line, which include vacuum erection device, intracorporeal injection, and intraurethral albuterol, or surgical treatment with surgical prosthesis. We'll focus mainly on the primary care, which we will done by nephrologist, urologist, internal medicine doctor, by everyone. What are the reversible causes or treatable causes that I can do for patients with erectile dysfunction? Remember that you should correct anemia. Look for anemia and correct. Look for the medication if the patient use, if he used certain antihypertensive drugs like beta blocker or central acting drugs, please change to alpha blocker or angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitor. So patient complaining of erectile dysfunction and having beta blocker or central acting drugs, please try to change. If you saw that he has a severe psychological problem, has severe anxiety, severe depression, you can refer to psychological evaluation. Very important point is hormonal therapy. Patient with hormonal abnormalities. If you correct these abnormalities, this patient become normal again. What are the hormonal abnormalities mostly common seen? You may found patient with hypogonadism, patient with hyperprolactinemia. Remember that also thyroid problem, either hypothyroidism or hyperthyroidism, may lead to erectile dysfunction. Testosterone therapy is given to main patient with laboratory evidence of low testosterone level, men with hypogonadism. There is no evidence satisfied to give testosterone for patient with normal testosterone. If I have normal testosterone, addition of testosterone will not add much to my erection. So patient who could benefit from testosterone therapy are usually young men with hypogonadism. How I could give testosterone is either by parenteral or transdermal patches or here in the Egyptian market, we don't have transdermal patches. We have parenteral and oral. Remember, there is certain contraindication. Patient with cancer prostate or male patient with cancer prostate or liver impairment and a heart problem are contraindication to have hormonal therapy. The best replacement therapy is done by parenteral route. We have two forms, testosterone enantiate, sold in the Egyptian market like Cedotone or Stanone. It is 205 international unit. And the half-life for testosterone enantiate is 7 to 10 days. So we give a one ampoule every 2 to 3 weeks by intramuscular route. One ampoule every 2 to 3 weeks. The other form is testosterone and the canweet. It is also given by intramuscular route, but they have longer half-life for 3 weeks, and we give it every 3 months. It is sold in the Egyptian market as Nebido, 1,000 milligram. So if you have patient with low testosterone and you want to replace it, you have two options. Either testosterone enantiate, give one ampoule every 3 weeks, or testosterone anticonate like Nebido, one injection every 3 months. The other important hormonal abnormalities is hyperprolactinemia. Dopamine is a chemical agent that, or chemical transmitter that normally inhibit prolactin secretion. Bromocriptine is a dopamine agonist that is used for decreasing prolactin and shrink pituitary adenoma. Bromocriptine is present in the Egyptian market, for example, like Parlodil or Lactodil, 200.5 milligram tablet. The main problem of these products is nausea and vomiting and dizziness. So usually you start with small dose. We usually start with half a tablet at bedtime, then after 3 days, half a tablet in the morning and half tablet in the afternoon. And after 3 days, one tablet at the evening and half tablet in the morning. And finally, we reach one tablet every 12 hours. So by day, we have two tablets, this maximum dose. Then according to prolactin level, you continue your treatment. So bromocriptine, 2.5 milligram, maximum dose is one tablet every 12 hours and start with a small dose and increase it every 3 days. The other is cabergoline, which is sold in the Egyptian market as Dostinox. It is 0.5 milligram. Again, the same side effect, nausea and vomiting. Again, we should start with small dose, usually with half a tablet, twice a week. And we may increase up to by half, quarter of a tablet every week. The maximum dose is 1 milligram twice a week or 2 tablets twice a week. So you start with half a tablet twice a week, increase every week by quarter of a tablet, you may reach up to 2 tablets twice a week. So please remember that the first line for management your patient with erectile dysfunction is to look for a correctable cause, not to hurry and give him oral erectogenic agent. The underlying cause may be treatable, like hormonal abnormalities, like hypogonadism and hyperprolactinemia. The underlying cause may be treatable simply by correcting anemia or change medication, or to improve the psychological problem of your patient. If I found no treatable cause or no underlying problem, or I cannot improve the underlying problem, I may use the first line of treatment, which are BDE5 inhibitors. We mentioned early in the physiology of erection that BDE5 is an enzyme inside the cell that causes destruction of cycloguanidine monophosphate, so it interrupts the pathway for erection. Inhibiting this enzyme will make the cascade of erection continue. So oral erectogenic agent inhibit these enzymes. What are the BDE5 inhibitors available? Currently, we have 4 drugs available under the group of BDE5 inhibitors, which are sildenafil, tadalafil, vardenafil, and afenafil. And all are available in the Egyptian market. Sildenafil, of course, we know all of us, Viagra, which is a brand name for it. Tadalafil, we have Cialis, we have Diamond Recta, we have Starcobix, Vardenafil like Levitra. Avenafil is the most recent drug introduced in the Egyptian market. It is called the second generation of BDE5 inhibitor. This drug has advantage of less side effect and it can be taken on full stomach. All these groups share the same side effect, and it is usually due to vasodilatation. Vasodilatation causes headache, flushing, rhinitis. All these due to vasodilatation. But specific for sildenafil or Viagra, there is blue vision. Why is this okay? Because it inhibits BDA6 in the retina. And this causes some blue vision in this patient, usually with high concentration or high dose. Tadalafil also have, or Cialis have vasodilatory effect, but specific for it, it has myalgia or back pain. So oil share the vasodilatory effect. Blue vision is characteristic for sildenafil and backache for Cialis. Tadalafil. The dose for sildenafil, starting dose is 50 milligram up to 100 milligram. We have tablets with 50 and we have tablet for 100. Starting dose is 50. For Avanavil, the starting dose is 100 milligram. In the Egyptian market, is Urvanavil or Atkunafil. Tadalafil, Vardenafil, the dose is 10 up to 20 milligram. The absolute contraindication for use of PDE5 inhibitor are patient with ischemic heart taking Natarat or patient with hypotension. Patient with ischemic heart and are not taking Natarat are not contraindication. You can use PDE5 in this patient, but with caution according to the cardiac condition. Why it is contraindication with Natarat? Because all these drugs cause some hypotension. And Natarat causes vasodilatation and hypotension. Concomitant administration of BDE5 inhibitor with Natarat causes severe or profound hypotension that may endanger the life of the patient. So the absolute contraindication are ischemic heart with Natarat and patient with hypotension. When you prescribe BDE5 inhibitor for your patient, you should tell him this warning. You should tell him that the pills does not work by itself. You need sexual stimulation. If I took that drug without sexual stimulation, nothing will occur. Why? Because the cascade of erection to start, I should have sexual stimulation to release nitric oxide. Then nitric oxide will go into the cell to stimulate guanylyl cyclase and the cascade of erection. Okay, so need of sexual stimulation is mandatory. Sildenafil and vardenafil should be taken on empty stomach, because high lipid content impair its absorption. But tadalafil and avanafil can be taken with food. You should warn your patient about the side effect. You should tell him that may cause some headache, may cause some running nose, it may cause some flushing. Because some patient, when this side effect occur, they feel that something wrong happened and they are afraid to continue and they stop taking the drug and sexual intercourse. You should tell him that the drug may not work from the first time. You should try it several times. And even if it doesn't work, don't worry, we have other options available. So please tell your patient, these are very important. You have to do sexual stimulation. Take it on empty stomach if sildenafil and tadalafil. Sildenafil and vardenafil. So. And don't worry about the minor side effect that may occur. If I use BDE5 inhibitor and it doesn't work, this is called BDE5 failed. But when I say BDE5 failed, the patient should try at least 6 to 8 times with the maximum dose. So for example, if I use sildenafil, I should take 6 to 8 times with 100 milligram. I should take the drug with appropriate sexual stimulation and with appropriate timing. What is meant by appropriate timing? Usually we tell the patient that you take the drug and wait for nearly 1 hour until maximum absorption and you start sexual intercourse. So take 6 to 8 dose of maximum dose with appropriate timing, with appropriate sexual stimulation, with appropriate use. If I use it on empty stomach or full stomach. So if the drug does not work for the first time, this is not called failure. All these items should be fulfilled to say there is BDE5 inhibitor failure. How I could manage patient with BDE5 inhibitor failure? First, I should check that the patient is using a licensed medication with correctly used If it is okay, I will share four associated risk factors. If he has hypogonadism, I should replace testosterone. If he has severe obesity and severe smoking, he should gain weight loss and stop smoking. Some patient may not respond to certain type of PDE5 inhibitor, but may respond to another. So change the PDE5 inhibitor. For example, if I use sildenafil and does not work, change to other type. I may use tadalafil, vardenafil, venafil. So change the type of PDE5 inhibitor. If I change and does not work, I may use a small, long-acting daily dose of PDE5 inhibitor. For example, if I'm using sildenafil without response, I will use 5 milligrams of tadalafil daily and increase the dose at the time of intercourse. So regular dosing with small, long-acting PDE5 inhibitor is a very important line for management of patients with PDE5. So check that the patient is using the drug correctly. Modify associated risk factor like stress, anxiety, obesity, smoking, hypogonadism. Change the type of PDE5 or using small daily dose of long-acting PDE5 inhibitor. I think many of you now hear about what's called low-intensity extracorporeal shockwave therapy. I think it is now used for treated patients with nephropathy. And it's also used now for patients with erectile dysfunction. What is low-intensity shockwave therapy? All of us know that shockwave therapy is used for treating renal stone, but this high-intensity shockwave. In low-intensity shockwave therapy, the shockwave causes micro-trauma to the tissue. This will stimulate angiogenic factor that will release in the tissue that will cause new vascularization. This new vascularization will improve the vascular supply to the targeted area or the targeted organ. So if an improved the blood supply to the penis, this may improve erection. And this is the rationale for using of low-intensity shockwave therapy for the patient. Low-intensity shockwave therapy is very simple and very safe treatment. Usually the patient have 300 shocks at 5 sites different at the distal and mid-proximal penile shaft, left and right corpora. The patient does not need any analgesia during the session. We usually give the patient 12 sessions, 3 sessions per week for 2 weeks successively. Then we have rest for 2 weeks and then we continue another 6 sessions in over 2 weeks. From our experience, low-intensity shockwave usually have good results in young patients without comorbidities and with short duration of erectile dysfunction. But old patient with atherosclerosis and multiple comorbidities, usually it is not a very effective treatment. So usually we reserve this line of treatment for young patients without comorbidities and with short duration of erectile dysfunction. If I have PDE5 failure, what are the other options that I can tell your patient you have? We have the second line and the third line. Second line include vacuum erection device. Some authors consider vacuum erection device as first line, not the second line. It is formed of cylinder, which is connected to a pump. Pump, this may be manual or automatic. The cylinder is placed over the penis, completely tied to abdominal wall, so there is no leak. By your hand or by automatic button, you will create a negative pressure inside the cylinder. Negative pressure inside the cylinder would suck blood into the penis, so erection occurs. Then when erection occurs, I remove the cylinder and by elastic ring at the base of the ring, the base of the cylinder, I will make it at the base of the penis. This will prevent blood to escape from the penis. is very safe, can be used in every patient. But the problem with vacuum erection device, this ring prevent blood supply to the venous, so I cannot make it more than 30 minutes. Also, it has good constriction, so it may interfere with ejaculation. Also, because there is no vasodilatation, the venous is cold. It is just suction of blood, no arterial dilatation. So there is benign coldness. Second line is intracorporeal injection. By using a syringe for insulin, we inject either papaverine or prostaglandin as single agent into the corpora to induce smooth muscle relaxation and vasodilatation of arterioles and sinusoid. The problem with intracapnular injection that most of patients are afraid to inject themselves inside the penis. Also, there is some pain during injection. With repeated injections, there is fibrosis in the penis. All these are side effects that may limit its use. The last item of the second line is intraurethral albuterol, and we don't have here in Egypt the same idea that you put prostaglandin, but inside the urethra to avoid benign injection. So a pellet of prostaglandin are put by applicator into inside the urethra to avoid use of prostaglandin as intracorporeal injection. Finally, if the patient has failure of all lines of treatment, I may use benign prosthesis, which may be semi-rigid or inflatable. And of course, it is done by specialists, and no need to take much about benign prosthesis. So the second part of our lecture is what is the effect of renal impairment on erectile dysfunction. Actually, patients with chronic renal impairment have very high incidence of erectile dysfunction. In some series, it reaches up to 90% of patients have erectile dysfunction. The etiology of erectile dysfunction in patients with chronic renal failure is multifactorial, and it is mainly organic in origin. And we have several factors. What are these factors? We have arterial problem, we have neurogenic problem, we have hormonal abnormalities, we have endothelial dysfunction, we have the effect of medication used, the effect of anemia, the effect of psychological abnormalities. As all you know that your patient with renal failure have accelerated atherosclerosis. Atherosclerosis is a very common cause for erectile dysfunction. Also, patients with chronic renal failure have hypoxia. Hypoxia due to either anemia or pulmonary hypoventilation. Hypoxia stimulate collagen synthesis leading to fibrosis and decrease nitric oxide synthesis. So fibrosis and decrease of nitric oxide will lead to incompetent veno-occlusive dysfunction, or what is called venous leak, but it's called veno-occlusive dysfunction. So vascular problem is very important, either arterial or venogenic. Also, patients with chronic renal failure have either neurogenic problem like peripheral neuropathy and autonomic dysfunction, and we have mentioned that are very important causes for erectile dysfunction. Endothelial cell dysfunction are present also in patients with chronic renal failure. We mentioned that nitric oxide is released from the endothelial cell. Dysfunction of the endothelial cells to release nitric oxide is a common cause for erectile dysfunction in patients with chronic renal impairment and in patients with diabetes. This is very important for you. What are the hormonal abnormalities that may lead to erectile dysfunction is patient with chronic renal failure? We have low testosterone, and we have hyperprolactinemia in patients with erectile dysfunction. Low testosterone in patients with chronic renal failure is due to decreased production or presence of luteinizing hormone receptor antagonist. So decreased production or present of receptor antagonist to luteinizing hormone, which is responsible for increased testosterone production, lead to low testosterone in patients with chronic pain. Low testosterone will lead to decreased libido and will decrease the nitric oxide activity and will lead to replacement of the cavernosal smooth muscles with collagen fiber. All this will lead to erectile dysfunction, decreased libido, decreased nitric oxide activity, and replacement of the cavernous tissue with fibrosis will lead to erectile dysfunction. The other hormonal abnormalities, which is very important in patients with chronic kidney failure, is hyperprolactinemia. There are many causes for hyperprolactinemia, like increased production, secondary hyperparathyroidism, zinc deficiency, and decreased renal clearance, because prolactin is a polypeptide hormone. How hyperprolactinemia causes erectile dysfunction? Increased prolactin will decrease gonadotropin-releasing hormone. Decrease gonadotropin-releasing hormone will decrease luteinizing hormone released from the pituitary. Decrease luteinizing hormone from the pituitary will cause decreased testosterone production. So hyperprolactinemia and low testosterone in patients with chronic kidney failure. As all you know that most of patients with chronic kidney impairment has anemia. Anemia decreases the general well-being of the patient and decreases health, so this will lead to erectile dysfunction. Erythropoietin is may be used to treat anemia in patients with chronic kidney failure. And there are many studies that showed that use of erythropoietin to correct anemia will improve erectile dysfunction in patients with renal impairment. Another supposed etiology for erectile dysfunction in patients with chronic renal failure is zinc deficiency. Zinc is decreased in patients with chronic renal failure and hemodialysis due to direct removal during hemodialysis or decreased absorption. And it has been shown that oral zinc supplementation increases testosterone and increases erectile function in such patients. Vitamin D deficiency and secondary hyperparathyroidism. All of you know that vitamin D deficiency will lead to secondary hyperparathyroidism in patients with chronic renal failure. Hyperparathyroidism may lead to erectile dysfunction. Treatment with vitamin D may lead to improvement of hyperparathyroidism and improvement of erectile function. How hyperparathyroidism causes erectile dysfunction? Hyperparathyroidism will increase prolactin level. And hyperprolactinemia will finally decrease to low testosterone. So hyperparathyroidism will lead to hyperprolactinemia and will lead to low testosterone. The medication used for patients with chronic kidney failure may lead to erectile dysfunction. Some classes of antihypertensive we use, like beta blocker, thiazide diuretic, may lead to erectile dysfunction. Centrally acting drugs, antacids that we use, especially cimetidine. Most of the recent antacid does not cause erectile dysfunction, but the old one, cimetidine, lead to erectile dysfunction through formation of hyperprolactinemia. The antidepressant drugs that we use for patients with chronic kidney failure may also lead to erectile dysfunction. The psychological causes in patients with chronic renal failure is very important. And some studies have found that 30% of chronic kidney disease have depression. The etiology of depression in patients with chronic renal failure is due to several losses, either loss of kidney function, loss of well-being, loss of financial resource. Depression is a very known cause for erectile dysfunction. So we know now that it is a common problem in patients with renal failure. We know that the etiology is multifactorial. How I should evaluate a patient with erectile dysfunction, like general evaluation by history and the examination and laboratory test. And laboratory test, you should do serum testosterone and serum prolactin because of the higher incidence of abnormalities in such a patient. So evaluation, as we mentioned, in general population. History and examination is very enough with laboratory investigation. How should I treat? As we mentioned, the first thing is of the primary care is to modify reversible cause. Correct the anemia, change the antihypertensive drug. Correct the psychological states. Correct the hormonal abnormalities. This is very important in patients with chronic renal failure. But testosterone in patients with chronic renal failure may have some antagonistic effect. They found that testosterone increased the activity of nitric oxide synthase and BDE5 enzyme. This will improve erection. But on the other side, it increase the degradation of cycloguanidino monophosphate. Cycloguanidino monophosphate, which is responsible also for erection inside the cell by closing the calcium channel in the cell. So it increases nitric oxide, but it degrades cycloguanidino monophosphate. These are two antagonistic effects. This is why in some studies they failed to show an importance of testosterone, addition of testosterone to patients with chronic renal failure. So the role of testosterone supplementation in this category of patient remains controversial. Some studies showed some effect and some studies showed no effect. Again, treatment of patient with renal failure with erectile dysfunction, first, modify reversible cause, hormonal abnormalities, correction of anemia with erythropoietin, change medication of hypertension, improve the psychological depression of your patient. If you found no underlying cause or you failed to treat underlying cause, you may use the first line of treatment, which are the BDE5 inhibitor. We mentioned it's a classic. We mentioned how to use it. We mentioned what is called BDE failure and how to manage. And don't be worried. Multiple studies have showed that there is good efficacy and safety of BDE5 patient in chronic renal failure patient, like general population. But be aware that patient on renal failure, you should use small dose. Up to creatinine clear 30, no change of previously mentioned dose. But severe renal impairment, you should start with the fourth or quarter of the maximum dose. And don't give it on the day of hemodialysis because of the reported some severe attacks of hypotension in some patients during the day of hemodialysis. So first line of treatment is safe and effective, but start with quarter of the maximum dose and not in the day of hemodialysis. All other lines of treatment can be used like general population. Vacuum erection device, intracavernosal injection, intraurethral albuterol, low intensity shock, all can be used. But up to now, we didn't find a study for low intensity shock in patients with chronic renal impairment. But vacuum erection device can be used. Intracavernosal injection can be used. But beware that patient with chronic renal failure usually have coagulopathy. So intracavernosal injection should be done with caution because of formation of hematoma at the needle site. The third line can be used also for management of patient with chronic impairment, which is benign prosthesis. But usually, if the patient is going to have renal transplant, we usually reserve benign prosthesis till after transplantation because some reported improvement of erectile function after renal transplantation. So if the patient with renal failure, with failure to first and second line of treatment, and he is not going to have renal transplantation, we can do benign prosthesis with safety and without increased incidence of infection. if he is going to have renal transplantation, we wait until renal transplantation. The problem of inflatable pineal prosthesis with patient with renal transplantation is the formation of the site of reservoir, because usually the reservoir is put on the parapelvic space, and usually on the right side it is located by the graft, so usually you put it in the contralateral side. It's not a big deal. We can use semi-rigid prosthesis. So patient with renal failure has multiple comorbidities for erectile dysfunction. Evaluate as general and you treat as general. And remember, you should modify reversible risk factor. Don't forget. What is the effect of renal transplantation? Some authors reported improvement of erectile dysfunction after renal transplantation. And the improvement after transplantation may be due to normalization of metabolic and hormonal abnormalities and improvement of the psychological problem of the hemodialysis patient. On the other hand, some authors reported still there is high incidence of erectile dysfunction after renal transplantation. The etiology is usually also multifactorial, including anxiety. The patient after transplantation is worried about his future, is worried about the future of the transplanted kidney. Also some medication I use, antihypertensive. As we mentioned, that the main blood supply comes from the intentar bilirubin that I used for pineal vascularization, that I use for vascularization of the transplanted kidney. But in general, unilateral interruption of internal bilirubin does not affect the blood supply much to the penis, because I have bilateral supply. But second transplant is associated with very high incidence of of erectile dysfunction, because I interrupted post internal bilirubin artery. So second transplant has very high incidence of erectile dysfunction than the first. Also, etiology, I have underlying process. If I have a diabetes mellitus from the start, if I have atherosclerosis from the start, this will continue with me after transplantation, leading to resistant erectile dysfunction. How I should evaluate patient with transplant? If I have patient with normal renal function, manage him as normal person. Evaluation and treatment. If patient with transplant with renal impairment, evaluate as renal impairment and dose as renal impairment. So evaluation and lines of treatment in general are applied to renal impairment with modification of the dose and applied to patient with renal transplantation. So to summarize our topic, remember that there is high incidence of erectile dysfunction in your renal impairment patient. The vasogenesis is often multifactorial. There is no need for extensive investigation, do history, examination, and lab investigation. First line of treatment is to modify reversible causes. Look for anemia, look for hormonal abnormalities, hypogonadism, and hyperprolactinemia. Check the medication list of your patient. If there is no underlying treatable cause, you can use the first line of treatment, which is the BDE5 inhibitor. Remember to start with small dose in patient with renal impairment, quarter of the maximum dose, not on the day of hemodialysis. Failure means 6 to 8 times with maximum allowed dose, with good sexual stimulation, with good use of the medication. If I failed, I may change the BDE5 inhibitor, or I may use a small deal dose of long acting like tadalafil. All modalities in general population can be used in chronic kidney disease and renal transplant. Even the pineal prosthesis can be done safely without increased incidence of infection. Renal transplant often improve erectile dysfunction, but some patients still have resistant of erectile dysfunction after transplantation. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Professor Ahmed, for this very nice, very clear, very simple presentation, and reflects the deep experience you have in managing the patients with erectile dysfunction as it one of your interests. I agree with you 100%. Erectile dysfunction is very common in general population. This is the most common complaint in males. And it is very common in CKD and almost hemodialysis patients, almost, if not all of them, have erectile dysfunction. Some percentage reverse it after kidney transplantation because of improvement of prolactin after kidney transplantation. But after transplantation, the milieu includes a lot of issues that may be associated with erectile dysfunction. Fortunately, the use of BDE inhibitors doesn't interact so much with immune suppressive drugs, to put in mind. And you clarified a very interesting point that here in our center, we use internal iliac artery as an anastomosis with the artery end to end. This is for the first transplant.
Yes.
And for the second transplant, if the first transplant was on one side, internal iliac artery is used. For the second transplant, external iliac artery to avoid bilateral cutting the blood supply for erection. Professor Ahmed Halawa, he's a transplant surgeon at Sheffield Institute. When I discussed with him this point of view, from the start, even in the first case, in the first transplant, they didn't use internal iliac artery anymore. They used external iliac even for the first transplant. I think your presentation was very nice, clear, and it's now open for discussion. Dr. Karim Salim, you can help us to unmute Professor Faisal Shaheen to hear from him, his comments, and then Professor Saeed Khamis.
Okay, Professor.
Professor Faisal?
Yes, this is very excellent talk. It is easy to be understand and to be, you know, go to the target, what you want. I agree with you, sorry. I agree that this is a common problem in CKD patient and post-transplant patient. And I remember many years back when our patient went for transplant abroad, they were using an internal iliac artery, and Prof. Bayoumi was working with me at that time. And he told me that those people, they don't think about the sex after transplant. And that's why we have a couple of cases like this, and we started to investigate them, and we found that the anastomosis was an internal iliac, and this was the cause of erectile dysfunction. Nowadays, we don't use this. We do the external, and this is, we leave it to the surgeon, but we don't have such a big problem post-kidney transplant. But still, as you mentioned, there are many patients that are coming to us have the same problem, and we have to prescribe some medication for them according to the strategy which we use exactly. But my questions, probably if you have probably more experience with benign prostatic hypertrophy plus post-kidney transplant, what you are going to do regarding alpha blocker, which can cause some libido or some erectile dysfunction or retrograde ejaculations. What you give in such cases?
Alpha blocker actually does not interfere with erectile function. It is friendly for erectile function. The problem, the main problem is, as you mentioned, ejaculatory problem. It is called, cause what's called aspermia or sometimes retrograde ejaculation. This problem is very important in young patients. So in young patients that are need for fertility and for ejaculation, we use non-specific alpha blocker like Cardora or Dozin, but uroselective like Tamsulosin or Sildosin usually associated with this common problem. So if the patient is worried about his ejaculation, you can use non-selective like Cardora or Sildosin or Prostitrol or Zatral. This does not cause the ejaculatory problem. But okay. Alpha blocker does not cause erectile problem.
Well, I think it decreased libido. It decreased libido mainly, and the people are, this is a professional thing.
With alpha blocker, no, but you mean other lines of treatment of BPH, like deuterostride or finasteride, that interferes with testosterone may decrease libido and CS erectile function.
Yes, I agree about this point because so in such patients, what you're going to use? Cardora, as you mentioned. Myself, I don't like Cardora. I don't know why. I'm old fashioned because I have so many patients taking Cardora, develop severe hypotension after taking Cardora. And that's why I try to avoid it.
Yes, we usually start with uroselective, like tamsulosin or sildenafil. If the problem of ejaculatory problems occur and this is annoying the patient, we shift to non-selective.
Okay, thank you.
If you allow me, Professor Faisal, regarding the point of first dose symptoms after alpha blocker, to put in mind, because sometimes we neglect it and even can occur after increasing the dose. So be careful, and all of us should be careful. And I like the more selective ones to be used for treating these patients for prostatic hypertrophy. And I think after transplantation, a very interesting point mentioned by Professor Al-Asmi is hypogonadism. If there is hypogonadism, although the experimental studies in animal documented the problems with kidney perfusion and kidney function, but if the patient is has hypogonadism, we should treat hypogonadism because this is a big problem. Hypogonadism will reduce libido and will be associated with erectile dysfunction. So it is not wise to start with sildenafil and the patient is hypogonadal. Am I right, Dr. Ahmed?
Yes. That's what we say. We have to modify the reversible cause.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor. Thank you very much, Professor Faisal. Thank you very much. Professor Saeed Khamis?
مساء الخير دكتور حسين ومساء الخير دكتور فيصل والدكتور احمد محاضره رائعه كالعاده يعني
مساء الخير الله يخليك
الموضوع طبعا شائك ومطلوب للكثير من مرضانا فعلا انا بس في نقطتين بالنسبه للترانسبلانتيشن كنت عاوز اسال حضرتك فيهم بالنسبه
Would you please ask in English دكتور سعيد because the presentation is all English
so, okay I will okay
yeah, okay please
Number one, regarding the patient with retransplantation, either second or third transplantation. I know that it's not common in our country, but I think Dr. Hussein will help us in this also. Because
we have a big cohort of second, and we have a couple of cases for third transplant.
Yeah, so to retransplant in the same side, it will lead to more impotence because of this Steele syndrome, as you said. How can we overcome this problem? This is number one. Number two, is there is any drug interaction between BD5 inhibitors and the common immunosuppressive medications? Thank you, sir.
Regarding drug interaction, Dr. Saeed, I think it is very minimal, if there. And I prefer to review it in our pharmacology, but for the best of my knowledge, there is no major drug interaction with sildenafil, so it is okay to go ahead. To put in mind the graft function, because if the patient has graft function, it's better to start with a very small dose and go slow, respecting the drug dose modification.
That's good.
Regarding the first point, Dr. Ahmed, the how to reduce Steele effects, Steele phenomena, and preserve the vascularity for the patients. So, who will be subjected to second or third transplant.
As you mentioned that transplant on the second side, you should do inside with the external iliac, not to use the internal iliac artery.
Okay. But is there a problem after transplantation regarding this point in some patients with peripheral vascular diseases or something like that?
Actually, this is a point need to be investigated where we should
go okay.
for the second transplant.
Dr. Faisal, Dr. Faisal, do you like to comment here? Dr. Faisal, unmute Dr. Faisal Kareem. Kareem.
Thank you. Dr. Ahmed, I wonder if we have some sort of re-anastomosis if the problem is the steel phenomena, probably we can have some re-anastomosis. And we were thinking about this long time back. And I don't know either we did it or not. What do you think about from neurological point?
What do you mean by re-anastomosis? Sorry.
No, if we have a steel, but if you are an iliac, probably you can take a graft and make it from one to another in order to increase the blood flow to the venous. I think this can be done. Theoretically, can be done.
Theoretically, there is vascular surgery to improve erection, benign arterialization with anastomosis inferogastric to the either deep dorsal artery or deep dorsal vein. But vascular surgery is very limited in use, actually. If you have
patient, I think if it is like this, I prefer the vacuum or the prosthesis.
Or prosthesis is very safe. We have done in many patients with xenon transplant.
Okay, the question here, Professor Lasmi, if you decide to do prosthesis post transplantation, is there a safe period to be or a period to be after 6 months? Or
yes, you should have stable graft function and at least after 6 months after transplantation with a stable graft function.
Okay.
Thank you very much for this point. But regarding Professor Faisal, regarding the transplantation, I have followed up many male patients. The main aim of renal transplantation is to have normal erectile function after transplantation. So We shouldn't neglect, because sex may be behind many symptoms. And in Arab world and in Egypt, as you know, the patient may not coming directly complaining of erectile dysfunction. This is why we should be clever when we take history from these patients. Yes, some women, even some females, wives, came to complain even, but the majority are still conservative, and the patient can complain of gastrointestinal upsets. So we should put in mind, because it is alive to have. And I remember one of the African guests and African trainees in our hemodialysis course, he mentioned that sex is the most important goal of life in some areas. And I think the life, to eat, to drink, to have sex, these human needs. Am I right, Dr. Ahmed?
Yes. it's not the important goal for us.
I just added some point to you. One of the
things
we encourage the patients to get a transplant is to have a normal sexual life and to have a kid. This is one of the things which we said it to the woman, that you can have a kid after transplantation, and also for the man that your sexual life will improve after the transplantation. This is one of the tools which we encourage the transplantation.
But we should separate kids from erection, because the male may, the erectile dysfunction may improve, but fertility may not improve. As you know, mTOR inhibitors may be associated with a sperm or defective spermatogenesis, and other drugs may even lead to defect of little cells like calcium inhibitors and others. To put in mind that there is some concordance between erectile and fertility, and some disconcordance in another areas.
Okay, agreed.
Okay. Any other points? I think there is a question in the chat, Dr. Lasmi. If you, doctor, if we write in the chat the questions, question one, to measure, where we can find the recording of the lectures. I'm going to upload the video today or tomorrow morning, and you'll find it for you, for the public. And you can follow the link on our face messages. What is the level of prolactin that I can start Dostinex or Lactoderm, Dr. Lasmi?
Of course, it sometimes it differs from lab to lab, but up to 20 micro is 25 is okay. From 25 up to 50, there is elevation and you can start. If it is above 50, you should do MRI for pituitary to exclude the pituitary adenoma. So above normal, you can start, but above 50, start treatment and you can do MRI for the pituitary.
Excellent. So you mentioned, you answered the second question regarding the need of MRI. We expected to find hyperprolactinemia and renal failure, and we witnessed some patients with even galactorrhea associated with hyperprolactinemia. So if the prolactin level is very high, we may expect presence of adenoma, pituitary adenoma. Yes. Type and the name of long-acting PDE5.
Long-acting is only Tadalafil. Tadalafil is available in the market here in Egypt. Cialis, Star Coprix, and Diamond Rect. You have 20 milligram and you have 5 milligrams. For intercourse, you can use 20 milligrams on demand. When you can use small daily dose, you use the 5 milligram.
Okay. If we measure testosterone, do you prefer total or free testosterone?
Free is the active form. I usually do both ones. Free is the active form. This is most important.
Okay, I enjoyed your the sector of your presentation about testosterone, because there are a lot of debate to use it or not to use it. But if there is extreme low level associated with manifestation of hypogonadism, it's better to correct.
Yes, it's better to correct. If it doesn't work, okay, but it's better to correct.
Yes. Do we need to frequently measure testosterone for CKD patients with erectile dysfunction, or once diagnosed with hypogonadism and receive treatment, there is no need for repeated measurement?
No, in hormonal abnormalities, it is guided by serum testosterone or prolactin. You have to follow up your patient. For example, hyperprolactinemia, you can use medication for 1 month and repeat prolactin level. Also for testosterone, I will give 3 injection, and the problem with testosterone that it is it has half life, as we mentioned, that testosterone enantiate or like acetylstone or cystinone, the half life is up to 10 days. So plasma level is increased up to 3 weeks, okay, with nibido okay. Or testosterone and deconate. The plasma level is elevated for 3 months. So you can give for a while and stop and measure it again. There's no need to repeat every time. According to your complaint.
What are the long-term side effects of using BDE inhibitors in hemodialysis patients?
Long-term? There is no long-term effect. Sometimes after you use BDE5 for a long time, your patient is complaining of decreased response to these drugs. This is only long-term. He usually try to increase the dose, and usually it has decreased the effectiveness of such.
But no. And to avoid, as you mentioned, the absolute contraindication in the presence of nitrates in treating these patients. We shouldn't deprive our patients from BDE5 inhibitors. And as you mentioned, some of them are being tested in treating proteinuria and others. So a lot of issues are there. Even females can use Viagra for treating pulmonary hypertension. So a lot of issues are there. So I think it was very nice presentation, very clear.
Just a question, if you have patient with taking dinitra, for example, and you want to come here BDFAP, you have to stop nitrate at the day of intercourse. And you have to ask the cardiologist if I can stop dinitra at this day or not. So it is a combination between urologist and the cardiologist to stop Nitromac and give BDE5 in such a group of patients.
Very nice comment, Dr. Lasmi. Why? Because the role of nitrates nowadays in treating chronic kidney, coronary heart disease is declining. So if it is added from the first time after coronary heart disease, and now there is no indication to continue, it's better to stop them after the cardiology guidance, and then to treat one of the very frustrating issues, which is erectile dysfunction. That is very common in even, and for a funny comment, and I ask Dr. Lasmi sometimes to say, erectile dysfunction among doctors, among patients. So it is very common complaint. Professor Saeed Khamis?
Sorry, Dr. Hussain, last question to Professor Asmi regarding the patients, what we call the nephrology is still having residual renal function. I mean, starting dialysis and still passing urine and have residual renal function. Is there is any study denoting that residual renal function has a beneficial effect on this the incidence of erectile dysfunction? That's number one. Is a complete anuric patient has any psychological effect regarding the erectile dysfunction? Thank you.
So I think it needs studies, Dr. Saeed. It is not the Professor Lasmi issues. It is our issue. But even in CKD patients who has no end-stage kidney disease, the erectile dysfunction is so common.
Yeah.
And the cocktail of medications are associated with problem, as you know. So I think maybe because, as you know, the presence of residual renal function is associated with better outcome than if the patient is totally anuric. But I think it will be negligible for the issue.
It is a multifactorial problem. It does not depend on presence of urine or not.
In 1 or 2 milliliter per minute.
Yes.
It is
a multifactorial.
But it needs to be tested if residual renal function is associated with survival.
Yeah.
Maybe associated with some preservation if it is 80%. In hemodialysis or 90%, maybe if the patient has residual renal function, it will be 75%. So it is, at the end of the day, it's very common scenarios. But I remember here, treatment of anemia, using ether therapy like erythropoietin, as you mentioned, is excellent, increasing oxygen carrying capacity and improves the erectile dysfunction. But the problem is using some other drugs may contribute to the erectile dysfunction. And if we say on nandrolindican weight, because it was commonly used even by non-nephrologists, by urologists, even to treat patients with CKD, I think I don't like this class of drugs, either for males or females. And if the patient is hypogonadal, we can use nandrolindican weight in males, not in females.
Okay. Yes.
Dr. Saeed, do you want to add or to
ask? I'm totally satisfied by the very good lecture and your discussion.
Professor Faisal, do you like to comment or to close this session?
It is excellent and important talk, actually. We learned a lot. Thanks to
the Thanks.
So in behalf of the Egyptian Society of Nephrology, Continuous Medical Education chapter, and all the nephrology community, we thank and appreciate the efforts done by Professor Ahmed Asmi to deliver a very interesting, in a very simple manner, in a professional way, erectile dysfunction in general, CKD, dialysis, and transplantation. Thank you very much, and the presentation will be uploaded soon. Thank you and goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Second.